right. If you love me, you will obey my commandments. It couldn't be more simple or profound. It cuts right to the heart of the matter and turns every empty excuse upside down. We don't prove our love through obedience. Obedience is proof of our love, produced and developed as a response to our God and our Savior, the one who first loved us. That's why as Christians, we must never be reduced to a group of good moral people who do good moral things. We must always be known as sinners in great need whom God has graciously redeemed. And I know it's obvious, so let's be honest. All of us were once lawless, defiant, and lost in the darkness, but the grace of God was revealed that we might receive the fullness of his promise. This is why, even as we strive for perfection and toil to the point of exhaustion, even as we pour out the substance of our lives and keep the word hidden inside of our hearts, we realize we have no room to boast. We have no room for pride. Based on our own merits, each one of us should have died. We were dead in our sin, but God's Spirit made us alive. And with this in mind, I'm reminded that obedience was never optional. The call to follow Christ is not simply doctrinal. Good doctrine is no excuse for poor discipline. Disobedience is sin. That's how humanity got in this predicament. We had a covenant with God, but we broke our commitment, deserving and earning death. God's wrath is his rightful, righteous reaction to our sin. And although for the Christian, our debt has been paid, if Jesus didn't make a way, what would you say standing before a holy God on Judgment Day? Think of the implications. What if Jesus refused to obey? All hope for us would have been lost. He was tempted in every way, but he was obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. A redemption plan to save man that only he could execute. Lived and died in our place, fulfilling God's law as our substitute. In perfection, he purchased our pardon, solved our biggest problem, called us to walk with him, learn from him, and walk like him. Behold the Son of God, our exemplary example. Oh, how he loves us. He did everything for us, and it changes us. That's why Jesus, the Christ, must never be reduced to a good moral man who did good moral things. He must always be defined as the true divine resurrected Savior and King. And we will praise him for his grace. It is by grace we have been saved. And as the gospel spreads and disciples are made, we must teach and train those disciples to observe his words and obey. It's disobedient not to teach obedience. Think of the implications. We are a people set apart for his own possession, being conformed to his image. Obedience was never a secondary side trimming. And proper theology should help push us further along the path of personal purity and spiritual maturity. What are the implications of claiming to have faith absent of obedient action, with heads full of knowledge but hearts with no passion, professing to believe but lacking spiritual fruit in practice? I'm asking, what are the implications of claiming that the Spirit of the living God lives inside of you, but when it comes to obeying his word, you are actively passive? Not to be confused with the salvation gained by our works. We are saved by faith in Christ, consecrated to God in new life and new obedience as a result of the new birth. So for the areas where we have disobeyed, we must call it for what it is and confess it. Turn away from our sin in repentance. He is faithful and just to forgive our offenses. By the blood of Christ, we are cleansed, accepted, and protected. And the call to obedience reminds us how much we need the gospel and keeps us daily dependent. So if you feel overwhelmed, if you're afraid of failure, take heart. Yes, the flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. God's plan will never fail. What a privilege it is that he has called us to be a part. I appeal to you, therefore, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. This is your true and proper worship. Amen.